Okay, so let's look at a couple of different ways of making geometry using NX. We'll start by starting a new drawing or a new part model. So we'll click New, and we want to be on the Model tab, and we're going to make a model. We want it to start in sort of in model with the model template. We want to make sure that we're using the units that we prefer. We need to give it a name and a location. Let me start by browsing for a location. Yes, that's where I want it to be, so I'll select that that directory, and I'll give it this name, end plate 1. And it looks like that's all good to go. I'll say OK, and I have a new model started. In the middle here you see I have a datum coordinate system already made. This is already a thing in my drawing. I could delete it if I didn't want to use it, but I do want to use it, so I'm going to hit Control Z and put it back in there. I'm going to undo using Control Z. So up here also are your undo and redo commands. Those are handy. Of course, I've already been over the view commands, so I can rotate this thing around however I want to and just have a look at it. Alright, so I'm going to go in here and I'm going to put in some geometry. First, I'm going to use the design features. I don't really recommend using these. I don't think these are the preferred way to do things anymore. However, you will see lots of old models out there that are built this way, so I do like to talk about it. So we'll insert a design feature, namely a block, for instance. And you can see that I get this little dialog box here. Whoops. There we go. Okay, so he gives me some options here. We're not going to explore all of these options every single time because NX is filled with them. There are just millions of different options for the different commands. So we're going to put this block in, and these are the dimensions of our block. The length is going to be 0.95 inches long, the width 0.7, and the height is going to be 1/4 inch. He's asking me where I want to put the block. He's asking, you know, I've said I want to give you an origin and an edge length, and or edge lengths. He says, well, I need to know the origin. And actually, since he has a little check mark here, that means that that's already been satisfied. And you can see here he is defaulted to put the origin at the, well, at the origin. And when it's orange like that, that means this is the step that you're on. So if I'm clicking in this screen, then I am selecting an origin. I'm not giving it a length or anything like that. And so I'm just going to go with that. Now I have some choices down here. OK, apply, and cancel. These may work a little bit differently than you may expect. If I say apply, then he goes ahead and he will make that block for me. This is kind of slow. Jeez. Okay. Now, if I hit cancel, you might expect that block to go away, but that's not the case. All cancel will do at this point is to dismiss this dialog box. If I had hit OK, then he would have made the block and also dismissed the dialog block, the dialog box. But so that takes a little bit of getting used to. That's a little different from a lot of software. So now I'll cancel and be left with my block. Now if I realize that I mistyped something or this is not the size that I wanted it to be, I can double click the block and go back in here and edit those parameters. Alright, so that's one way to make a block. I'm going to go ahead and delete that. And I'm going to show you a different, more universal way of making geometry, and that is to use a two-dimensional sketch and then give that sketch some kind of thickness in some kind of way by sweeping it, extruding it, revolving it. You'll see what I mean. Alright, so we'll start by entering a sketch, and like I said, this is a two-dimensional sketch and it exists in a three-dimensional drawing, so what we have to do is situate or orient that sketch somehow in our two-dimensional drawing. Here you see he has again defaulted to the XY plane. I can flip that around and choose a different plane if I would like to. Let's see. There we go. Alright, so in this case I've chosen to place my sketch in the three-dimensional space and have clumsily not aligned, and I should have just taken the default, but you'll notice that my X, the X and Y of my sketch is not aligned with the X and Y of the model. We'll talk more about coordinate systems later, why this might be a problem, but for now I'm just going to go with it. So what I can do in this mode is I can make a boundary. Let me just come in here with this profile tool and kind of show you what I mean. So, I can come in here and just sketch a two-dimensional fence, basically a boundary around an area that I want to extrude. Let me just show you real quickly what I'm talking about by extrude. So I'll finish the sketch and I can hit extrude. And, oh, that's interesting. So this extrude, I must have been doing something wild the last time I was in here. Okay, so we take that boundary and we give it thickness. Okay, so that's one way to do it, is with an extrude. Let me just delete this. Another way is to revolve it. So I can come in here with my revolve command, take this boundary, and let's see, revolve it around, say, this as an axis. And I've taken that same shape and that same boundary and changed it into a completely different shape. Alright, so that's what that's sort of the general approach here. I'm going to delete my sketch out of here. I don't want to have a sketch in there that I'm not using. And let me give myself a chance to start over and do this a little bit better. So we'll take a sketch, and you see if I just take the defaults, then I'll have a lot better luck getting hold of that coordinate system. There we go, that's better. Alright, so I want to make a rectangular shape. I can just come straight in here to the rectangle. Here, this is the overall best way to do this. I'm going to make a rectangle. I have some choices about how I want to construct that rectangle. I'm going to go with from center. That's a very handy one for doing this kind of thing. And I pick the location for it. And now I'm telling it the width. And you see that as I tip it, if I'm tipped up, he's willing to let me put a tipped in rectangle if I would like. Or if I sort of get horizontal, you see that little symbol pops up, and that means he will constrain this this direction to be actually aligned with the horizontal axis of the sketch. Now my width, I can actually key this in at this time, or I can just go ahead and draw my rectangle, okay, because with parametric modeling, the shape is a different entity, it's a different thing from the size. So these are two separate things. That's what makes it parametric. We have shapes and then we give them their size. Now you'll notice that these are not just four lines, these are four lines that are related to each other in very specific ways. For instance, the endpoints of this line and the endpoint of this line, they line up, they coincide with each other, they are coincident. This line is perpendicular to this other line. You see this little symbol here, that's a constraint symbol. These are geometric constraints that are controlling how these different two-dimensional elements relate to each other. Okay, let me just slide over here and show you what I'm talking about. You see, I can have a line at an angle, or I can have a line that is horizontal. You see that little dash in the middle means this is a horizontal line. You'll notice that a lot of other stuff popped up when I drew that line. He put dimensions on here. He said this line is 0.71. This line is located a certain distance away from these other entities. Alright, let me get rid of that. And let me show you. See here, this is telling me this is 1.16 inches long, 1.219 inches tall. But those are just driven dimensions. They are not dimensions that have any influence over the drawing at all. All he's saying is, to create this, he's saying the sketch is fully constrained with two auto dimensions. Now, What that means is the geometry is constrained, but the size is not constrained. These auto dimensions mean he needs some kind of size information. All right, so let's give him the size information. Our block again is it's going to be 0.95 inches in that direction, and in this direction it is going to be, come here, 0.7 inches. Okay, close this out, and you see that it is going to center this rectangle about the point that I selected, in this case the origin of the sketch, and it's going to center it vertically as well. Now let me just show you some unique things here about parametric modeling. You see it doesn't just say 0.7, it says P7 equals 0.7, and here it says P6 equals 0.95. Each of these dimensions that I assign in here are actually parameters. They can be defined other ways than just clicking them in there. For instance, let's say I want it, the block to always be twice as tall as it was wide. I could come in here and I could, instead of saying that this is 0.95, I could say, well, this is P7 times 2. Let's see, is that going to work? There we go. So you see, we could define it like that. In this case, that's not what we want to do. So I'll need to, instead of just editing this text, you see, since I've defined it as an equation or a formula, I need to come in here and actually edit it as a formula. So let me just go back to whatever that was supposed to be, 0.95 inches. Okay, so that's a little preview of things to come. So when I'm satisfied with this, when this now says sketch is fully constrained, it is indeed now fully constrained. And so I can finish the sketch. If your sketch still says that you have auto dimensions, you need to get rid of those. While I'm in here, let me show you real quickly one of the biggest challenges that students have. You see, I just deleted my dimension and this auto dimension came back up. Okay, here's the thing. You don't need to be a slave to these auto dimensions. What they're saying is the NX is saying he needs information. It may not be this. What may be important, for example, might be the distance from this upper left-hand corner down here to this lower right-hand corner. It all depends on the design intent. So let me put a dimension in here from there to there. Maybe that's what's important to me. Okay? And maybe that should always be 1 inch. Or maybe it should always be 1.5 inches. And maybe this vertical distance is not really what matters to me. Maybe what matters to me is this. Okay? You'll notice that now, with that information, he no longer needs any auto dimensions, but this is a completely different auto dimension than the one that he had suggested. Let me get rid of this now. Alright, now my auto dimension is saying, oh, this is 1.5 inches from corner to corner. Okay, he kind of got left in that mode. But that's not what's important to me in this case. What's important to me is, in fact, that vertical distance. Let me try again. There we go. And it is 0.95. Okay. And I will finish this sketch. Now, you will be stuck in the sketch task environment until you do click that little checkered flag, so make sure you understand how that works. So now I'm going to take this and I will extrude it. And I'm going to tip it up so I can see my extrude. Do notice you have lots of options with extrude. I can extrude away. I can make this start off of my part. I can make it start, or not my part, but at my boundary. I can move it off the boundary to start it. I can even do things like offset it. I can do a single-sided offset, so I can actually make the part larger than the boundary that's creating it, or in fact smaller than the boundary that's creating it. I can do a two-sided extrude, two-sided offset. Okay, so lots of options there. I don't actually want an offset. I can, I can draft this thing. Give it an angle. And I can draft it from where it starts, or I can draft it from where my section is. Oops, I may have broken it there. There we go. Okay, so I've got lots of options there. Actually, I don't want a draft, and I don't want an offset, and I don't want to start out in space like that. I just want a block that's a quarter inch thick. Alright, now notice again, I hit apply. I probably would have been better off to hit OK, so now I have to take the extra step of hitting cancel because I'm done. Alright, so there's our block. Now, that may seem like a much more convoluted approach. However, it is a nice general solution that works for all kinds of geometry, not just rectangles and squares and things. Okay, so now I'm going to put some holes in here. Now, holes are probably going to seem a little bit more complicated than they need to be, but they're just a really nice solution. And let's go in here and we'll put some holes in here. I'll show you what I'm talking about. We want to put in a general hole. Our holes are going to be counterbored. And what he's actually asking for now, you see I'm on this, he's at this orange spot, and it has this little asterisk, which means that he needs some information. He wants to know where the holes are going to go. So this is just, think about machining, you would actually go in and you would lay out where you wanted the holes to be, so we're going to do that. And I could select points if I had a point that, for instance, if I wanted to put the hole dead center in here, there was a point already there. And I could have just selected that point, but since I selected this face, he's going to ask me to create a sketch and then place point entities in that sketch wherever I want the holes to be. So I'm just going to say okay. He takes me in here. I'm looking at the face, and he's saying select points. Where are the points? Where do you want the holes to be? Well, you might be thinking, well, I need to put them in a very specific spot, and that's true, but what we're going to do is just make the points first, and then we'll dimension to where those spots are. So I've got two points in there. They may be hard to see. Let me try to tip it so you can see a little bit better. All right, so there are the holes, and there, so you see the little point entities are right there. All right, so what I want to do is get those holes in the right place now. So what I want the holes to be is not, I don't care about how far they are from the edge, from the center. First of all, what I care about is the distance from one hole to the other. Alright, and so I'm going to dimension that with a rapid dimension. The distance from one hole to the other should be 3/8 of an inch, 0.375. There. Now, notice that an auto dimension went away when I did that. Also, there was no auto dimension from hole to hole. That's don't let the auto dimensions control you. You're in charge of the auto dimensions, not the other way around. Now what I want to do is constrain these. Now I've heard that NX has a new constraint. Let me just see if I can make that work. Well, you have to, well, blast. I'm having trouble selecting those points. So what I can do is come in here to my selection filter and just filter out points. So I'd say I want that point and that point. And this is a horizontal alignment, so I can say I want these two aligned horizontally, and you can see that constraint goes in there like that. Now I'm going to undo that, because if you have an older version of NX, that's not going to be an option. So what I like to do is to actually connect these two with a line, and then come here, and then, oh, let me undo my filter there, and then say this line is to be horizontal. Okay, so you see what I've done there is I've said this point is coincident with the endpoint of that line. That's what that little knob is, and the same thing for the other point, and the line that connects them is horizontal. Now if I select this line, I have options to put constraints on it, and I've already got a horizontal constraint, so that is what I want. Now I'm gonna just convert this into reference geometry out of force of habit. We will talk about reference geometry later. But you see it grays it out, and that means he's not going to try to generate any kind of geometry from that. Now I'm going to take a line, and I want to constrain the midpoint of that line to the midpoint of this block. You see it kind of light up there. Okay. The reason I want to do that is because I want these two holes to be lined up directly above the midpoint. I'll take this line and I will constrain it. Oops, it wasn't fast enough. My constraints went away. So I'm going to click the line and the relevant constraints pop up. And I'll say I want it to be vertical. And then I'm going to click the line again and say, and I want it to be reference geometry. Now, you see he has an auto dimension here. This just reminds me, hey, I need to know where you want the holes oriented vertically is what he's saying now. Now, I could take my dimension and I could actually apply dimension, say, from the center to this line. But what I care about, in fact, is the distance from the bottom. So this is 0.25 inches up from the bottom. All right, so there are my points nicely laid out. That's all I need in this sketch, and I will say finish. And he comes in here and puts in some the dimensions for my counter bore. Now, the reason those look so nice is because I did this just a few minutes. Well, I did this yesterday, and he has maintained that. The dimensions that I got came from the Machinery's Handbook. We're using a number four socket head cap screw is going to hold this onto our sign bar. So that's where I got the dimensions for that. And the depth of the hole, let's see, our number four socket head cap screw, the depth of the hole needs to be greater than H. So I come in here and look at height H. I see it has a min and a max. My hole needs to be deeper than the maximum height of the socket head cap screw. I made mine 0.115 deep. I can see I've still got plenty of room to make that a little bit deeper. If I make this, say, 0.120, then I have made life easier on the machinist. I can open up my tolerance on that and still be sure that the heads of the... I can open up the tolerance on the depth of that hole and still be sure that the head of the screw is beneath the surface. And I still had plenty of material to attach with. Okay, so anyway, these are the correct sizes for the counterbore. Oh, let me show you something. So this is my Machinery's Handbook. He told me that the diameter was 7/32. Okay, so what I could do is I could figure out what 7/32 was by typing it into the calculator, or I could just remember what it is. However, if I don't want to go to all that trouble, I can actually just key in 7 divided by 32 and apply that there. Okay, and so he has no problem doing a little bit of math in these cells. Very, very handy. All right, so that's our part, and it is now complete. One other thing. Funny thing, this file does not actually exist right now. Even though I went in and I said I want to create this file, he hasn't actually made it yet until I save it for the first time. So now the file does actually exist, and so I can access that later.